Hello and welcome to our webinar, Investment Connection Live for the Virginia Area, Summer 2020, Part 2. I'm Jean Rourke from the Federal Reserve and I'll be your moderator. Before turning our call over to our first speaker, I'll run through a couple of call logistics. If you haven't joined us through the webinar yet, go ahead and click the link you received after registering. I'll highlight just a few important connection notes for you. You can listen to the audio through your PC speakers or through the phone. If you use the phone option, slides will not sync with audio unless you change just one setting. And you can do that by selecting the gray gear located on the upper right corner of the slide window, just above the presentation. And from there, you should see a few options in the media chooser. And that's where you can select the phone option. Now you only need to make that adjustment if you're listening through the phone. If you're streaming today, you can sit back and relax and enjoy the show. You can expand the size of the slides, and to do that, use the Maximize button in the upper right corner of the slide window located on the webinar player page. And using the Materials button, you can access the following items, the event agenda, the PDF of our combined presentation, each of the proposals associated with today's presentations, and also the speaker's biographies. I'd like to specifically note that if for any reason you lose your connection or slides aren't transitioning, you can always download the PDF of that presentation and follow along. We'll also be taking your questions after each presentation, and you can send those in using the Ask Question button on the player page. And we'd love to hear from you anytime during the event, so feel free to send those questions in. I'm going to share the disclaimer today on slide 3, and then I'm going to turn it over to Christy. The views expressed here are the presenters and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond or the Federal Reserve System. So I'm going to turn it over to slide 4, and it is now my pleasure to turn our call over to the Community Affairs Officer at the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond, Christy Clear.
Thank you, Jean, and I'd like to welcome everyone and thank you for joining part 2 of the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond's Investment Connection for Virginia. This is a really exciting program, and Investment Connection brings together nonprofit organizations and funders in the regions that we serve to explore community development opportunities that specifically support low and moderate income, distressed and underserved communities. Next slide, please. So as you're probably aware, there are 12 reserve banks, and the Richmond Reserve Bank serves Virginia, Maryland, Washington, D.C., North Carolina, South Carolina, and most of West Virginia. We launched Investment Connection in D.C. and Maryland in the fall of 2020, and we're excited to be expanding the program into regions in Virginia. We could never have predicted that the rollout of the Investment Connection program in Virginia would have occurred during a global pandemic, leaving so many of our district's small businesses, nonprofit organizations, and low and moderate income communities so vulnerable. Next slide, please. So to better understand COVID and its impact on our communities, the Richmond Fed fielded a survey of small business lenders from March 16th to April 1st. We received 44 respondents from Virginia. And as you can see, even relatively early in the pandemic, lenders in Virginia were anticipating significant disruption to their small business borrowers and loan portfolio. If you look at the chart, we asked Virginia lenders how they anticipated accommodating small business borrowers who were impacted by COVID in the future. And almost two-thirds said they would likely curtail future loans to help accommodate loan requests from existing customers and to help stabilize their existing portfolio. From April 8th to the 10th, the 12 Reserve Banks and the Board of Governors also issued a survey to community development organizations to better understand the impact of COVID on their organizations and the community. Next slide, please. And there were 186 respondents that operated in Virginia. And when we asked them how long they expected their communities would need to return to pre-operation, pre-COVID levels, the results confirmed that Virginia organizations and communities are hard hit. Over two-thirds of respondents anticipated a significant disruption and difficult recovery for their communities, predicting it would likely take 10 months or more for them to return to pre-COVID economic conditions. We invite you to review other actions by the Federal Reserve System and the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond in aiding recovery by visiting our social media pages and our website for COVID-19 resources. Next slide, please. It's especially important during these times that resource matching initiatives such as investment connections are needed and aid our most vulnerable communities. And we all have very important roles to play. Today you're going to hear from 10 CRA eligible high impact programs. And I encourage you to seriously consider these responsive and innovative requests. So once again, we thank you in advance for your time and interest, and I'll turn the conversation to the Virginia and West Virginia Community Development Regional Manager, Tiffany Holland Wright, to share logistics related to the event, and then we'll get right to our live pitch presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Christy, for your remarks and for your support of the Investment Connection Program in Virginia. I would also like to extend a thank you to our applicant review team, which was supported by our supervision and regulation team and our community development team, our corporate communication, publications, and IT teams. We sincerely appreciate your commitment to making the Investment Connection Program a success. Next slide, please. What you'll find today is a set of presentations from 10 different presenters. These proposals came from several regions throughout Virginia, including Central Virginia, Southside Virginia, Hampton Roads area of Virginia, and Northern Virginia. The proposals will be presented in 5-minute increments, followed by 5 minutes for Q&A. As long as we can stay on task, we certainly invite you to ask questions after each presenter, and we'll have the presenters address those questions, and then we'll move on to the next presenter. We ask that you stay engaged throughout the process, and we will provide a 5-minute break right at 10:45 to give you time to stretch and prepare you to listen to the next set of presentations. We encourage you to communicate with our presenters directly. Before and after each slide, you will find email addresses, phone numbers, and in the materials section, you will also find the master presentation with the same information as well as presenter biography. After the presentation, we'll ask you to respond to a survey. If you find that you have to leave early today from the call, we have provided access to the survey via the webcast screen under the survey tab. You may also receive a follow-up call after today's meeting asking you what your response was. In addition, you can go on to our Investment Connection website to learn more about the program at the Investment Connection website link that's provided here, and you can go to the funders portal. Next slide, please. You can access the funders portal directly from this button, and you can create a username and password. If you decide to go on to our website, you can also access the funders portal via a screen that will show you a view proposals button. The next slide also, Jean. Creating a username and password is free and there is no obligation, but it gives you access not only to the proposals that are provided today, which are 10, but an additional 8 proposals that were highlighted on June 2nd, and additional proposals that are also deemed potentially CRA eligible. Next slide, please. Finally, today, we are active on social media, thanks to many of our internal partners and organizations that are presenting. We ask that you follow the Richmond Fed's Twitter page, which is Richmond Fed. You can also follow us on LinkedIn and Facebook, and you can retweet, you can share, you can post about this event. On YouTube, you'll find several of our presenters have provided promotional videos, and they're about a minute or so long, and they give you a very good highlight of what the proposal is asking for support regarding. So with that, I think we're going to get started with our very first presenter, and we'd like to welcome at this time Bonnie Sutton. Bonnie is going to present to us Access College Foundation's proposal on COVID relief for college-bound students. Bonnie is the President and Chief Executive Officer for Access College Foundation. Bonnie?
Good morning from the Access College Foundation. Next slide, please. Access provides educational pathways to students who may not otherwise have that opportunity. We've been a leader in the field of college access and success since 1988 and provide a unique continuum of services free of charge to the students we serve. Our services are targeted towards low-income students who are less likely to attain higher education because of socioeconomic factors. COVID-19, with its furloughs and job losses and other disparities, have left our families with even fewer resources than they would normally have. Next slide, please. Over the last 32 years, more than 72,000 low to moderate income public school students have enrolled in a certificate or degree program after high school because of the help of Access. We have secured over $719 million in scholarships and financial aid for our students and awarded more than $12 million in Access Last Dollar scholarships meant to help bridge the gap between the cost of college and the financial aid we helped them secure. In the school year that just ended, we helped 4,000 students with the college process, leveraging $35 million in financial aid. That number will continue to increase until August, and we awarded $700,000 to 114 members of the class of 2020. We are seeking grant money today for two primary purposes. First, to award additional scholarships to the class of 2020 at a cost of $5,000 each for up to 36 students. And it could be anywhere from 1 to 36 students that need that help. These are students that we've identified who still need us to help them bridge their college funding gap. And secondly, we are seeking annual fund in the amount of $25,000 to start the next school year out strong. We need, quite honestly, sneeze guards for every single one of the access desks at the high schools. We need an increased budget for college application fees and AP test fees for families that won't be able to pay those, and a special fund for housing and advanced tuition deposit payments that their families also won't be able to pay. Here's a fact you will probably love. For every dollar we spend on program services, we leverage $20 in financial aid for our students, quite a return on investment. Starting in Norfolk in 1988, our services are now available in 9 school districts: Norfolk, Portsmouth, Chesapeake, Virginia Beach, Suffolk, Northampton County, and new this year, Western Tidewater in the districts of Southampton and Surrey counties and the city of Franklin. And you see, we have advisors serving middle schools, high schools, and we're also on 13 Virginia college campuses. Next slide, please. The impact that the Investment Connection partners could have on Access could be critical. We want to ensure that our services are sustained next school year. We want to continue to support the pipeline between low-income communities and higher ed, and we want to advance the strength of tomorrow's workforce. Here's how we want to do that. The impact of COVID-19 on our families has made our services more critical now than ever. With the reopening of schools, the current plans here in Hampton Roads are that there will be about half-time in-person attendance, and so that means we need to continue to enhance our virtual opportunities as well as maintain the safety of our advisors for the in-person services. With the we've been in the business those opportunities for more success stories by bridging the gap between the college of cost or cost of college, excuse me, and families' resources with last dollar scholarships for our students. And we still have some unfulfilled needs from the class of 2020. And also, we're a key player in workforce development in our service area. We want our students to gain credentialing and degrees to get into the careers they desire and then come back to Hampton Roads and other parts of Virginia to work and live. You partners joining us today could really advance the strength of our area's workforce by ensuring that our students continue to receive this support to attend college and graduate, despite the challenges they faced before and after COVID-19. In closing, one of the most significant and amazing measures of our success is that regionally and nationally, only 59% of students who go to college after high school actually complete their programs and graduate in 6 years. With access, 90% of our scholars graduate, and they do it in 4 years, while only taking approximately 51% of the debt load of other students. This really starts them on a solid path for their future. Thank you so much for this opportunity, and I would love to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you so much for your presentation, Bonnie, and for your energy. We are happy to learn more about Access College Foundation. And in the spirit of the Community Reinvestment Act, I'm very interested to know, when you say you target vulnerable students, what do you consider low income and how you collect information regarding income from the students?
Sure. We have been using the federal poverty guidelines, and 77% of our students are at 300% or less of the federal poverty guidelines based on their family size. At first, for certain things like fee payments for applications, it's self-reported from the families, but by the time they're juniors in high school, seniors in high school, and college students, we are getting that data directly from the income tax form that's used to file that FAFSA, the free application for federal student aid, for them to receive financial aid. So those are verified statistics, 77%.
That's great. And so it's obviously clear that this helps to forge our workforce, particularly in the Hampton Roads region. Can you talk to us a little bit about any strategies you have in place to maintain relationships with the scholars and how that potentially can impact the workforce of your region as they pursue their professional careers?
Sure. Our primary strategy and really one of our key success stories that I didn't talk about too much today is our college success program. When I talked about those 13 college campuses that we're on, when we give these students, when we help them in high school and then those that receive our scholarships, it's kind of like the mamas and daddies want to do it. We just jump in their suitcase and we go on to college with them. So we've actually established offices on 13 different college campuses to help our students stay in school and graduate. And so we're maintaining that relationship. Then beyond that, we've created an alumni committee of current and former scholars. We also have two former scholars on our board of directors to continue to help with those relationships. And then the second part of that, your career question. We're doing some different things with a career connection program that we created in 2017 to really ramp up our non-college or non-degree partners as well. This year, for example, we had two scholarships that were established for someone going into the marine industry, which could have been any kind of pipe fitting or welding on anything that was a marine vessel. And then we also had a Cars for College campaign, and we are putting quite a few students into the automotive repair center with our local community college, Tidewater Community College.
Thank you so much for empowering the students of the Hampton Roads region, Bonnie. You have probably seen a polling question appear to indicate whether or not you have interest in finding out more information about Access College Foundation. And you'll also see contact information, a phone number and email to reach out to Bonnie Sutton directly. If you need more information about our program, visit our funders portal or the materials section. At this time, we'd like to invite our next speaker. Nicole Armstead is the City Treasurer for the City of Richmond's Treasurer's Office of Financial Empowerment. Nicole Armstead is going to speak with us today about RVA Financial Connectors. At this time, Nicole, I'm going to pass the microphone virtually over to you.
Great. Thank you, Tiffany. And great morning to everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. Let me begin by sharing that as a Richmond native, born and raised here, I have been able to witness firsthand the disparities within our community financially. And when running for office as city treasurer, I made a commitment to provide services to address that financial gap within our community. And that has resulted in our next slide, where you can see the Office of Financial Empowerment. Within the Office of Financial Empowerment, we are working to assist the Richmond population. We have 228,000 people in Richmond, and we have been acknowledged across the nation as number two in evictions. We have poverty, unemployment, and the single head of household being impacted so heavily within our African American and Latino communities, and it's been acknowledged that within Richmond, those two communities are twice as likely to live in poverty and to experience unemployment than that of the white community. So the need is tremendously there, and that's where you see the programs that we are offering through the Office of Financial Empowerment, our RBA Financial Navigators, as well as an Empowerment Center. You can see our accomplishments to date on the next slide. Upon taking office in 2018, we launched the Office of Financial Empowerment. We also have put together a financial empowerment board with financial, legal, and social service volunteers that provide input and guidance on the programs that we make available. We also launched the city's first ever financial literacy fair last year, and in addition, have been awarded a grant to launch a financial empowerment center for free one-on-one financial counseling from the Cities for Financial Empowerment Fund. So then we look at the challenges that we have, how can we end the cycle of poverty? And that takes us to our next slide. We'll see the financial stability building blocks. We see three steps in this model, and step one being the financial navigators. We already had these challenges prior to COVID-19, and now the need is greater than ever. It's only exacerbated our challenges. So we see the need, number one, having the navigator to help individuals know who to call, where to find resources, where to get that guidance. Because ultimately, a number of people that are experiencing these financial challenges are people that used to give to nonprofits. They've never had a need for financial assistance in this level. And so being able to help them know where to go beyond social services, what nonprofits and what programs are available to them. And then we see within step two, having the one-on-one financial counseling center, and that's our financial empowerment center. And this is a public service that will help them to improve their credit, their savings. And because it's going to be provided as a public service, it's going to be a trusted source, a trusted resource to our community. The Financial Empowerment Center is already in 30 cities across the U.S., and to date, they have eliminated $150 million in debt, served 108,000 individuals, and increased savings by $26 million to individuals, most of them on the poverty level. Step three is our long-term result, which is financial stability, ending the cycle of poverty, impacting evictions. Again, in the areas of African American and Latino communities, they are hit the highest in this region, and again, are twice as likely to experience this. So we're looking to increase the capital, make individuals bankable, and help to prevent the financial exploitation that's out there. Then we go to our final slide. And that's the funding opportunities. With our financial navigators making this available, that's $120,000 that will allow us to have three part-time financial navigators. In addition, with the Financial Empowerment Center, we currently have $150,000 from the Cities for Financial Empowerment Fund, and that's definitely what's going to help us. We've actually identified a budget for the Financial Empowerment Center of $300,000 and are also open to receiving funding there. But I will say on the right side of the screen, you see the community partners. Those are the individuals that are helping us to make this possible, and the City of Richmond as well being a key player in all of this. So we ask you for your support, for you helping us to help bridge that gap, to help end that cycle of poverty, and know that with Investment Connection, we can all make this possible. So I welcome any questions you may have at this time.
Nicole, thank you so much for such a dynamic presentation. This is a really interesting component of the resources that are already available in Central Virginia, particularly in the Richmond area. I'd love to learn a little bit more about how this financial resource for the residents differs from a financial opportunity center.
Of course, that sounds great. So with the Financial Opportunity Center, what makes us different is that we are going to provide experts in the area of finances. It's going to be tailored guidance. So we're talking about the individuals, especially within our Empowerment Center. They're going to be trained not only on budgeting and credit and savings, but housing on the levels of mortgages, reverse mortgages, rental, just being able to access housing itself, as well as bankruptcy. So it's more detailed guidance that's tailored to those individuals. And that also with the navigators, they're going to be able to give people guidance on what bills to give priority, helping them to prioritize their finances at this point and understand who they should give the attention to when they have creditors calling and harassing them. And that's where the FEC differs from that.
Okay. So we know that there are other call centers like 211. This seems to provide a financial value add to those who are calling in that others may be paying several dollars per month to receive this type of financial coaching. It's very interesting that the city is involved. Can you talk a little bit more about the city's role and funding, that how the funding
yes.
works?
Great, definitely. Sure. So the city's role is going to definitely be to help utilize this to link individuals to the agencies that the city already has with the different human services available, from definitely with our library as well as our community wealth building, the workforce centers there. And we also are looking to help provide oversight to ensure that the deliverables are being met within these centers. So as far as 211 as well that you mentioned, we will be able to work in partnership with 211, where calls that are going to 211 will be routed to the financial navigators. So in essence, we're helping to lift some of the weight where most of the 211 calls are more directed on human services and health type areas. This will be able to help hold that financial arm and provide more assistance there to help direct people within this region with those different services and who's available here.
Terrific. Thanks so much, Nicole. Hopefully the audience sees a polling question that's been provided. We ask that you respond to the polling question to express any interest that you may have in learning more about the RVA Financial Connectors proposal. At this time, we're going to also ask, there are some slight delays. And the contact information slide, if you are experiencing that on your end, please look at the materials section of the proposal. If there are any delays there, you can find the overall presentation and contact information for Nicole. At this time, we're going to move on to our next presenter, Kimberly Ballridge, who is the Executive Director for Danville-Pittsylvania County Habitat for Humanity. Help Habitat Help Others is the title of her presentation, and we ask that you would please direct your attention to Kimberly.
Good morning. The Danville-Pittsylvania County Habitat for Humanity in Danville, Virginia is an affiliate of Habitat for Humanity International, and our mission is seeking to put God's love into action by bringing people together to build homes, communities, and hope. Our vision is a world where everyone has a decent place to live. We have been serving residents in Danville and Pittsylvania County that have low to moderate income and are in need of decent, affordable housing for almost 30 years. My previous experience as a rental property inspector opened my eyes to the tremendous need for decent housing in our community and fueled a determination to make a difference. Next slide, please. Habitat Village North is our next exciting project. With this project, we have the opportunity to help 30 families realize their dream of home ownership and improve their quality of life. Next slide, please. Several years ago, St. Luke's United Methodist Church donated approximately 6 acres of land to our affiliate in order to build decent, affordable housing in Danville. And to make it even better, an anonymous member of the church donated enough funds to build our first home in this community. So we will not only be building new single-family dwellings, but an entire community with a playground area for the children to have a safe place to play and enjoy being outdoors. This land is located on the Danville City, Pennsylvania County line, and will be able to accommodate partner families that prefer a country-like setting, but be able to live near city amenities. Within a 5 to 10 minute drive, there is a grocery store, a pharmacy, and many restaurants. Habitat Village North will take place in two phases. Our goal is to begin the first phase next year by excavating 5 lots and then begin the construction of the first home. This project is a game changer for our organization, and we anticipate ramping up our building process in order to help families have a more stable home life. Within phase two, we will be installing a new road and start on the remaining 25 homes. Next slide, please. Home ownership has been an essential element of the American dream for decades. But just knowing that you have a roof over your head doesn't mean that it is a decent, safe, or healthy home. Research on home ownership indicates that children who grow up in homes owned by families perform better in schools than in children in rental units. There tends to be less crime in neighborhoods of homeowners because they exercise greater oversight of their neighborhoods and of one another's properties. Homeowners pay more taxes than the renters, which brings property taxes and expands the tax base. And also, homeowners have a greater economic and emotional investment in the quality of their neighborhood, thus increasing community stabilization. There is a great need in the Danville and Pennsylvania County area of Virginia for decent, safe, and affordable housing. In fact, our area is among the 13 cities and counties in Virginia that are defined as having extremely poor neighborhoods. The poverty rate in Danville exceeds 40%, and in Pennsylvania County it ranks between 20 and 30%. Next slide, please. Habitat has its strategy that has been proven to work by building strength, stability, and self-reliance with shelter. Decent shelter is the foundation to an improved quality of life that empowers families. Habitat families feel safe inside and outside of their home. It offers them a sense of accomplishment from helping to build their own homes and improves the health of each family member and creates a sense of confidence in a child's life in school and with their friends. But the COVID-19 pandemic created hardships for our organization. Following the directives of Habitat International, we closed our ReStore in late March and lost our main source of operating income. All staff were laid off, except for me. I actually continued to work part-time to keep the business going. So without staff and funds available, our Habitat Village project is in jeopardy. We have received enough funding to reopen the ReStore through the month of August, but in order to sustain our organization through the rest of 2020, we are requesting grant funds of $50,000 to cover operating expenses, retain our full staff, and keep the Habitat Village project moving forward. Next slide, please. Will you help Habitat help others with a grant of $50,000 to build our Habitat Village and improve the quality of life in the Danville-Pittsylvania County area? Thanks for this opportunity to present our organization's Habitat Village project, and I will welcome any questions at this time.
Kimberly, thank you so much for sharing your presentation, and to all of our organizations who are presenting today and not, you know, it is certainly a concern for us that you're experiencing some of the hardships that your nonprofit has experienced, which hinders your ability to deliver services to vulnerable populations. I would really like to talk to you a little bit more about your program, and I'm really curious, on a typical year, pre-COVID, pre-all that's happening in our world today, how many homes does Danville-Pittsylvania County Habitat build at one time or in one year?
Currently, our rural affiliate is at the point of building one home per year, but with this Habitat Village project, we really look to increase our funding and be able to increase our building process to accommodate more families, more than one a year.
Thanks, Kim. Can you tell us a little bit more about what the total expenses per month would be to operate? I understand your ask, but when you consider payroll, rent, and insurance, what is your monthly operating income? Expenses.
For those specific expenses, the payroll, rent, and insurance, it would be around $17,000. On a typical month, our total expenses, which span across our fundraising, management in general, restore expenses, as well as like program services for the family services, it can range or go up to at least $35,000 to $40,000 per month.
Thank you very much, Kim. For those who are connected via webinar, please note that we have submitted a polling question on the screen. We ask that you respond to that polling question to indicate whether or not you're interested in learning more about Habitat for Humanity. You'll also find contact information for Kimberly Ballridge and the Danville-Pennsylvania County Habitat for Humanity organization, both phone and email. Please do reach out to them directly. And you can learn more about this proposal in the materials section and pull up the proposal directly. Again, Kim, thank you. We're going to move on to our next presenter, and we would like to introduce you to Capricia Smith-Moses, who is the Economic and Community Development Administrator for the City of Richmond Office of Community Wealth Building. And today she's going to talk to us about the Mayor's Youth Academy, Virtual Career Connection. Capricia?
Good morning. Thank you, Tiffany, the Federal Reserve and Investment Connection. Next slide, please. As a member of the City of Richmond's Office of Community Wealth Building, I'm excited to share its quest to reduce poverty and empower citizens to build wealth. The people we serve have the greatest need. They represent low-income residents who make up approximately 22% of our total population. As we strive to develop more effective mechanisms to connect underemployed citizens to job opportunities, educational advancement, and wealth development, we expand that access to the City of Richmond residents of all ages. Next slide, please. Our concentration on eradicating poverty includes an increased emphasis on fostering the stability and sustainability of the family unit. Almost 30% of the families in our city have a household income of less than $15,000, and that number is being gravely increased by the pandemic. The Mayor's Youth Academy is the arm of our organization that serves 14 and 19-year-olds in the City of Richmond to address those needs and help them overcome the economic effects of COVID-19. In the City of Richmond alone, over 40% of children under the age of 18 live in poverty. Way too often, this dynamic directly inhibits their ability to enjoy the privileges that families with adequate income might take for granted, like safe communities, suitable housing, or even ample food. Through the Mayor's Youth Academy, teens are provided opportunities to increase access to those privileges through career exploration, job readiness training, leadership development, and much, much more. These young people also lead youth-relevant policy discussions and give back to their communities in service initiatives throughout the city. Next slide, please. The vitality of the future of our city is predicated on the success of youth-centered programs that have long-lasting impact, provide digitally inclusive opportunities, and address tough circumstances, especially those exacerbated by disaster. COVID-19 has challenged our ability to meet this goal conventionally, but with your investment toward our $200,000 goal, we can bridge the gap during this new normal and help teens succeed through the Virtual Career Connection. Because of its digital platform, the Virtual Career Connection would enable youth to engage in work experiences and internships virtually. Youth will obtain certifications in Adobe and Microsoft, engage in social action and civic engagement opportunities, and learn more about financial literacy, leadership, soft skills development, policy initiatives, and so much more, in spite of the pandemic. This priceless experience is designed to change the odds for those teens who have been hindered by inequitable access to safe neighborhoods and adequate education and sufficient economic stability, to say the least. Next slide, please. For every dollar invested, $7.49 goes out to the wages our participants earn as we endeavor to create policy and structural changes that result in a coherent ladder out of poverty. And if you're interested in making a difference in the lives of the most deserving youth of our city, you can see here how wisely your contributions will be applied as well. The majority of your gift will go to bridging the economic gap for our youth through direct stipends for completion of these experiences. Enrichment activities that bring art and other disciplines to life will be provided to solidify learning as well. Since the majority of our youth rely on local infrastructures for transportation and technology, we're requesting your assistance to address those needs when COVID-related gathering restrictions are relaxed and an increase to access families who are impacted by the digital divide. The remaining elements of need rest with the offering of logistical components for credentialing so that these youth walk away with even more earning potential. As you can see, this modest $200,000 investment will go to impacting the lives of those who have the greatest need, especially in the wake of the COVID pandemic. Next slide, please. These are just a few highlights of our virtual career connection, and of course, I'm happy to share any additional details upon request. Special thanks again to the Investment Connection for the opportunity just to invite you to join us on our path to reduce poverty and build wealth, one person at a time. I appreciate your time, and I thank you in advance for your investment in the future of our great city, our youth. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Capricia. We certainly recognize now more than ever, particularly as we're seeing such an increase in the number of those who are unemployed, that there are limited opportunities to reengage in the workforce, and we appreciate your proposal to facilitate that occurring with these students. Can you give us an idea of how many youth potentially could benefit from this program if you are fully funded?
Oh, thank you. Yes, we currently serve about 225 youth in our existing programs. With these funds, we would be able to expand our capacity to another 200, who represent almost 18% of the pandemic impacted poverty rate.
Thank you, Capricia. I was really intrigued by the policy, training, exposure to certification opportunities. Are there other outcomes that you anticipate students will gain from participating in this initiative?
Oh, definitely. We plan to apply the Quest model, which we would use the outcomes to manage the quality by leveraging subject matter experts. We would leverage engagement by expanding our reach to more teens. We would leverage skills by increasing access to soft skills development, like emotion management, initiative, inclusion, empathy, time management, to say the least. And then we would also increase our access to transfer by empowering teens to become more employable, and they in turn develop a transferable credential.
That's terrific. Thank you so much for your time. To the audience, I'd like to remind you that there is a polling question where you can submit whether or not you are interested in pursuing more information about the proposal that Capricia just shared with us from the City of Richmond Office of Community Wealth Building. In addition to that, you should be able to see contact information for Capricia Smith Moses and the Office of Community Wealth Building, both by phone and email. Learn more by clicking the materials section of your screen. Again, thank you, Capricia. At this time, we recognize that many of us have been Zoomed out and virtual, exhausted from virtual meetings, and we would like to give you an opportunity to take a break on the contingency that you will return, because we've got some exciting high-impact proposals that would definitely like to share what their needs are, and hopefully we can get some good support for these programs. We received a question in the queue regarding whether or not any of the dollars that are being requested will promote self-starters, startup companies that would be headquartered in Central Virginia, particularly in Richmond. I would like to say that if you stay tuned, you will learn about some of the proposals that are intending to address small business lending and seed dollars in the Central Virginia area. You can expect to hear from Partnership for Housing Affordability, People Incorporated of Virginia, which we'll talk about forgivable consumer loans. Also, the Piedmont Housing Alliance in Charlottesville. We'll talk about financial stability and housing counseling. In addition to that, there'll be a presentation from Maggie Walker Community Land Trust on minority home ownership and equity investment from Virginia Community Capital for the CDFI component of the bank. And finally, around child care and other essential services for our essential workers in response to COVID-19. You will have approximately 5 minutes on your break. You will hear music. Please keep the questions coming. And to all of our presenters thus far, thank you for your time. Welcome back, everyone, to Investment Connection Live Virginia, the summer session, part two. We are going to get right back into the swing of things. We have not received additional questions in the queue, but please do remember that that is available to you, and we welcome your questions, as do our presenters. At this time, we'd like to welcome from break Javon Burton, who is the Director of Implementation for Partnership for Housing Affordability. Javon is going to speak with us today around the Richmond Regional Housing Resource Line. Javon?
Thank you. Next slide, please. First, I would like to say thank you to the Investment Connection Program for providing us with this platform to help improve the lives of those in the Richmond region. My name is Javon Burton with the Partnership for Housing Affordability. And PHA has a firm vision of ensuring that everyone in the Richmond region will have a stable, healthy, and affordable place to call home. And our proposal, the Housing Resource Line, is a great step towards realizing that mission. Next slide, please. So the need for this project was not a wishful idea of PHA, but rather something that was spurred by a cry for help from both residents and service providers. A lack of coordination isn't just about convenience, but rather the inability in many cases to prevent a foreclosure or one's roof from caving in. A dysfunctional system means that we're going to have more residents in the eviction pipeline and service providers who are overburdened by resident calls. And you can see here on the screen, I have quotes from both residents and service providers speaking to the challenges that they face because of the lack of coordination that exists around housing resources and services. And the housing needs in our region are certainly vast. We have more than 50,000 low-income residents in the region who pay more than half of their income on housing costs. And this puts people in the predicament of being at risk of eviction or foreclosures, of minor rehabs and repairs transitioning into major rehabs and repairs. And many of these instances are preventable. Preventable if individuals knew where to go to directly to gain access to existing housing resources. But because of that lack of coordination, that leads to a lot of resident confusion, which also leads to our service providers, whose mission is to deliver housing services as opposed to redirecting residents to where they need to go. Our service providers are spending as many as 3,000 to 4,000 calls in a single month from residents around the region. Next slide, please. So our Housing Resource Line model seeks to alleviate these challenges. The Housing Resource Line will be a centralized phone-based access point to connect residents with existing housing resources. The idea is that an individual will call into the line, outline his or her needs, complete a brief intake process, and then will be provided both verbally and electronically with resources that they qualify for and that meet their specific housing needs. The resources will span a service provider network that exceeds 50 organizations, and this project will also serve residents from 8 jurisdictions across the region. And it's estimated the overwhelming majority of the folks who will be served by the Housing Resource Line will be those that are low to moderate income residents, earning below 80% of the area median income. And we can be sure of that because of the strict program requirements that are offered by our service providers that we've already been engaging with. Now, we know that this model will be successful because coordinated entry, having a single point of access, is something that's already been achieved in homelessness in the Richmond region, and it actually serves as the blueprint for the Housing Resource Line. So the scope of services with the Housing Resource Line picks up right where the homeless crisis line leaves off and extends all the way from emergency financial assistance and legal aid to gaining access to home ownership. We've actually already met with more than 20 service providers over the last 3 months to get vital feedback and buy-in on what needs to happen in order for this project to be successful. And we've received buy-in as well from the 8 participating jurisdictions. So with the successful implementation of this project, the region will now have a fully coordinated housing spectrum that serves all of the needs along the continuum. Next slide, please. So to answer the question of what does investment connection mean to the housing resource line is simple yet impactful. This $50,000 from investment connection means funding for one full-time specialist at a living wage, and this $50,000 ask also represents more than 1,200 callers helped per month and roughly 15,000 callers throughout the year. Investment connection can help open the door to housing stability, whereby hundreds of low-income individuals would be connected with rental or utility assistance, prospective home buyers would be linked to down payment and closing cost assistance, and so much more. It's not just providing access to prosperity to a few, but preserving stability for the lives of many. And this project will also help reveal real-time data that can influence programmatic change. We'll be able to know which zip codes are seeking the most services, which services are in the highest demand, and the demographics of those individuals. Housing challenges are deep-seated and complex, but no one should lose their stability and livelihood simply because they didn't know where to go to find existing help. And the Housing Resource Line will help make sure that that no longer happens. Thank you for your time.
Devon, thank you so very much for such a responsive proposal. Clearly, right now, again, with unemployment rising and so many who are subject to potentially lose their homes, both via rental or home ownership, this is a needed service. I'd like to know if you can share with us a little bit more about how you plan on tracking the data for the callers who call in and whether or not they actually get connected with the services that they're seeking.
Yes, so we will actually have a fairly sophisticated tracking system and software that each time a caller calls into the line, once they do their intake process, giving information of where they live, their income level, household size, and a few other demographic components, that will create a record for each individual that calls in. And as they're doing that, by the time they finish the intake process, the system will actually populate only the resources that directly relate to what they need and that they qualify for. And then we're going to meet with our service provider network quarterly for them to tell us how many individuals that they have serviced or gone through their programs that came directly from the Housing Resource Line.
Terrific. We anticipate clearly that the need will be very high, particularly in the next few months. Can you talk a little bit about the anticipation of the volume you expect to receive and how you'll build staff capacity to handle that?
Yeah, so we certainly anticipate that this need will only grow within the next few months, and so we're trying to be strategic about that. And that includes just being engaged with the service providers who are receiving those calls now, presenting to them what the value proposition is of if we take those calls off of their hand, how more efficient they could be. And how many calls are they getting? So, for example, we know that in Henrico County, the Department of Community Revitalization gets about 40 calls a month, and Housing Opportunity Made Equal gets 900 calls per month. Understanding all of that from our service providers helps to inform us how we can build out assumptions on the call volumes that we'll expect to get. So we have assumptions that we'll get about, be able to handle 50 calls per day with 2 specialists to begin with, and assuming an average of 8 minutes per call once we're able to get a handle on the process. And so that's about a capacity of 2,000 to 2,500 calls a month with the anticipation that we'll continue to scale up with our partners and build capacity as this program grows and as we learn more information.
Okay, and I just have one other interest because the Federal Reserve Bank along with FDIC and OCC are constantly engaging our financial institutions and looking for community needs that are emerging and which banks can respond to. Are there service opportunities in addition to the funding support that you're requesting and which financial institutions can engage with this initiative?
I mean, absolutely. We're really casting a wide net for all the services that are out there, and whether that's by nonprofits or financial institutions, and we've been getting them engaged, and, you know, do you offer any kind of services to let folks know about the home buying process and getting connected with loan officers to increase consumer education and where they can go to understand, you know, the difference between mortgage forbearance and mortgage deferment and really the updates on those. So we've been including financial institutions and their service offerings within our resource network and service provider network, and we hope to continue to do so and build that network as this pilot begins and as we continue to grow. And we think that the need will certainly be there, and we think that there's also plenty of partners that we can continue to connect with.
Terrific. Javon, thank you so much for your time. I'm really interested in knowing who wants to learn more about Partnership for Housing Affordability. So if you could please respond to the polling question that's presented before you, and also feel free to reach out to Javon Burton directly via phone or email. If that's no longer appearing on your screen, we certainly invite you to log into the materials section and to search for more information about this proposal. Once again, Javon, thank you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So at this point, we are going to move on to our next presentation, but I do have some other questions that are coming in through our portal, so I'm going to just ask my presenters to gear up for the questions that are coming your way. So our next presenter is Brian Phipps, who is the VP and Chief Development Officer for Forgivable Consumer Loans, is the name of the proposal sponsored by the People Incorporated of Virginia. I think I owe Brian a better introduction than that, so I'm going to repeat myself. Brian Phipps, who's the VP and Chief Development Officer of People Incorporated of Virginia, is going to talk to us about forgivable consumer loans. Brian, please share your proposal with us.
Thanks, Tiffany, and thanks to Investment Connection for providing us with this opportunity. Next slide, please. People Incorporated is a community action agency and a community development corporation. We have been engaged in providing services for low-income individuals and families for quite a long time now. We were established in 1964, oddly enough, as the first rural community action agency in the country. But as you can see, we currently provide a wide variety of services to communities that are located throughout Virginia. We really concentrate on focusing on programs and services that are specifically geared to address community needs. And community development lending is one area where we have been able to excel over the past few years. And in 2002, to grow the scope and reach of our lending services, we established a community development financial institution. Next slide, please. As I mentioned, we've been engaged as a community development lender for over the past 25 years, and in fact, we pioneered microenterprise lending in Virginia in 1992. Over that period of time, we have really focused on developing a wide variety of financial products and services to really promote access to capital for unserved and underserved communities throughout the state, and have grown our financial products to the point where now we're able to offer microenterprise loans, small business loans of greater than $50,000, tourism development loans, and new market tax credits lending that we actually engage in across the nine-state region throughout the Southeast. But one of the areas where we are seeing significant growth potential is in our consumer lending. This really is one of the more popular financial products that we have, and this is the focus of our project and our specific funding request for the Investment Connection. Next slide, please. Our proposal stems directly from the COVID-19 pandemic and our work in providing emergency assistance to local communities, and specifically to those that are hard hit by the COVID-19 pandemic. We are targeting this specific initiative on Prince William County and the cities of Manassas and Manassas Park, which for those of you that are familiar with Virginia and its battle with the pandemic knows that this is one of the more hard-hit regions of the state. Our specific request is for $75,000 of either equity capital or a 0% interest loan that is really intended to allow us to deliver direct financial assistance to households living in Prince William County. Through this project, we are proposing to offer up to $2,500 of direct financing to households that agree to participate in our initiative. The purpose of those funds is really to allow the families to meet their short-term financial or emergency needs. But rather than simply granting or handing out the funds to our participants, we are focusing on implementing an innovative payment-in-kind concept, whereas in lieu of our borrowers making periodic payments on their loans, they will be able to fulfill their repayment obligations to us by agreeing to participate in a series of budgeting and financial literacy workshops with one of our certified budget counselors. Their successful completion and participation in these sessions will result in their loans being forgiven at the end of the term. So, you know, we're in a typical loan, you would expect periodic repayments. With this concept, we are really looking for participants to become actively engaged with our budget counselors as a way to improve their overall financial sustainability and, you know, hopefully to weather the COVID-19 crisis, but also to be better prepared as they move throughout their lives. This idea really stemmed from the notion that, given the economic uncertainty surrounding COVID-19, many households, you know, although they have emergent short-term needs that they need to address, they are not in a position to take on additional debt. So that's really what's driving our interest in obtaining some equity capital where we can really test this concept and hopefully be able to equip these families with not only immediate financial relief, but also to help build their credit, to improve their financial literacy, improve their credit scores, and probably more importantly, help them with creating financial homes so that if they are currently unbanked, for instance, they will be able to be connected with a local financial institution so that they can obtain their financial services from them rather than depending on the methods that they've used to date. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions that folks might have.
Thanks so much, Brian, for your presentation. This is a very needed service, and oftentimes we don't necessarily see presentations related to consumer loans, related particularly to community reinvestment, but they are certainly relevant. Brian, can you talk to us a little bit about whether or not you are working with other equity investors for this particular initiative, whether in the past or current?
With this particular initiative, we have received some financing from the Appalachian Regional Commission and Appalachian Community Capital to really bump up and enlarge our direct financing assistance to small businesses in that instance. But in general and as a whole, People Incorporated has a lot of experience in working with a wide variety of philanthropic sources, conventional banks. In our New Markets Tax Credits program, for instance, we have over the past 8 years raised over $150 million in equity investments that we have subsequently deployed into high-impact projects throughout the Southeast. So we have a significant amount of experience working with our investors to deliver high-impact services to our borrowers.
Thank you, Brian. And just to make sure the audience is aware, there should be a polling question on your screen. We ask that you respond to that question to indicate whether or not you're interested in learning more about this proposal from People Incorporated of Virginia. Brian, can you talk to the audience a little bit more about how you propose to disperse the loan funds to those loan recipients that qualify? I know you all do quite a bit of direct service, so can you share a little bit more about that?
Sure, absolutely. As I mentioned during the proposal, we are, you know, placing an initial cap on the direct assistance that we will provide to families at $2,500. But rather than providing our participants with, you know, that initial full disbursement of the loan funds that we have allocated to them, we are going to make available, immediately available, once they enroll in the program, up to $1,000. To each of our participants, really as a way to determine whether or not they are serious about continuing along with us in the financial literacy workshops, in the budget counseling. You know, are they willing participants in working with our certified budget counselors to help address any other outlying financial needs that they have? So that will enable us to really figure out, you know, which of our borrowers are most focused and engaged with us, and if they successfully complete a first series of workshops, then they will have access to the balance of the loan funds that we're making available to them.
Okay, and I received a question that is really related to how the organization will help to sustain its funding streams and stay sustainable as we're experiencing so many layoffs and operations that have halted. Can you talk a little bit about how People Incorporated is sustaining its operations, particularly in response to COVID-19?
I'm very happy to. You know, one of the odd things about, you know, many nonprofit organizations and community action in particular is that when economic conditions, you know, downturn, that really creates more need than ever for the types of services that we're able to provide. So right now, as an organization, we are seeing a lot of funding opportunities come our way. All of our programs that we currently offer, whether they be funded by, you know, grants or by self-generated income, have remained intact. We did access the PPP loans as a means of sustaining the staff in only, I believe it was three of our programs out of 30. So we have not yet and don't anticipate in needing to lay off any staff or discontinue services. It's much the opposite. We are actually looking to grow the availability of the services that we're able to provide in response to the pandemic.
Thank you, Brian. We appreciate your responses to those questions. Again, if you're interested in the program, please find direct contact information for Brian on your screen, both a phone number and email and addition materials. If you find yourself in a position where you need to exit the call, we hope that you don't, but if you do, there is a survey button provided. We ask that you would please complete the survey before you exit the call. You should also receive a follow-up email with a survey link. In addition to that, if you don't get to hear all the proposals, definitely look at some of the materials that are available, but also visit our funders portal for these proposals and others that were presented in the past. So moving on to our next presenter, we're going to invite Kristen Lucas, who is Director of Housing, Counseling, and Economic Opportunity at Piedmont Housing Alliance. And Kristen's going to talk to us about catalyzing opportunities for residents to build financial stability in Charlottesville.
Thank you, Tiffany, for that intro, and thank you to the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond and the Investment Connection for this opportunity. With your help, we intend to build wealth in Charlottesville, Virginia for everyone, but especially for Black families. There is a racial wealth gap that, oh, next slide, please. There is a racial wealth gap that flows directly from our history. We have not valued the lives or work of Black people. 400 years of slavery, Jim Crow, and pervasive, more subtle racism have denied Black people opportunities for job advancement and to build wealth. Racial disparities in housing and employment in particular are rampant across our nation, but Charlottesville is particularly egregious. The homeownership rate for Black families in Charlottesville is 24% compared to the national average of 41%. The low homeownership rate can be attributed to exclusionary practices such as redlining, the raising of Black communities during so-called urban renewal, coupled with devalued labor through low wages and limited employment pathways. In fact, 53% of Black families living in Charlottesville earn under $35,000 per year, and 76% of families earning under $35,000 per year are housing cost burdened, which means that they have to decide between paying the rent, and feeding their family a healthy meal, or paying for a car to get to their job or multiple jobs and spending time with their family. These systemic issues have put Charlottesville in the lowest 3% of cities nationwide for opportunities for upward economic mobility. As we've heard low-income community members say, if you're born poor in Charlottesville, you die poor in Charlottesville. For over four decades, Piedmont Housing Alliance has helped 1,000 community members build wealth and purchase a home. We've also worked with countless other community members that have found a rental, avoided foreclosure, navigated fair housing issues, and increased their financial well-being. That history is great, but it is not enough. When you consider the Black homeownership rates are at their lowest in over 50 years since the inception of the Fair Housing Act, it is abundantly clear that taking the same approach will get us the same results, a system that has consistently denied Blacks the opportunity to participate in economic success. We've come to realize that we must do something differently to create equitable development within our community. Next slide, please. Part of working differently is recognizing that past interventions have been piecemeal and disconnected. We need to disrupt that system and create a space where people can easily access a variety of services that can take them from surviving to thriving. Each one of the resources on this slide is necessary, but not sufficient for moving a family to greater income. If any one of them is missing, it will be increasingly hard, if not impossible, for the family to achieve income independence. Network to Work, one of our partners, has created an award-winning technology where trusted community members can work with job seekers and help connect them to the quality employment they want and the wraparound services they need. With an app, the trusted community member and the job seeker can see what steps they need to take to reach their goals: improved employment, a higher credit score, and quality benefits navigation. They can also see and be connected to the resources that can help them achieve their goal: childcare, scholarships, affordable dental, low-cost auto loans, affordable safe housing, training. With a grant of $150,000, we will create a community-based one-stop shop where clients can find all of the resources they need, like career opportunities, education, childcare, food security, housing, and much more, to establish a pathway to prosperity. This financial opportunity center will be the place where people go to move from surviving to truly thriving. Next slide, please. A centrally located financial opportunity center will reduce the barriers to participation in the programs that can help families take those crucial steps towards prosperity. We have over 10 nonprofit partners who will co-locate in a centrally located financial opportunity center. Like us, these nonprofit partners want to do things differently. They recognize that while we want to create pathways to prosperity for our whole community, we must make sure we provide pathways to prosperity for the Black community. Our partners know that our systems were designed to disenfranchise and devalue Black people, and we must change that. We must do this collective work through a racial equity lens, because the problems aren't colorblind and the solutions can't be either. Piedmont Housing Alliance, acting as the lead partner, has multiple housing and financial counselors that can provide credit, budget, rental, and pre-purchase counseling. We also manage down payment loan funds that can help participants purchase one of the single biggest wealth drivers in our community, a house. Network to Work has career coaches, relationships with employers, and an innovative technology platform that can connect people with jobs that pay family-sustaining wages. United Way can help community members connect to quality childcare opportunities and scholarships. They have financial counseling, and they can also offer federal tax assistance. The International Rescue Committee and the Monticello Area Action Agency works with community members that need to fully take advantage of the social safety net programs they qualify for. Those are just some of our partners. Your grant of $150,000 will act as critical funding to help us establish Charlottesville's first financial opportunity center. Your grant will unlock the door for so many by providing a centrally located one-stop shop that brings together key players within our community to do their work. Charlottesville's first financial opportunity center will meet clients where they are and provide them with the skills, knowledge, resources, and opportunities to move towards a better future. Thank you for this opportunity to present to you all today, and I welcome any questions you have.
Thanks so much, Kristen, for your presentation, and I would like to extend an apology for some technical difficulties we had around the graphics related to the presentation. We encourage you to get the full effect of this presentation to look in our materials section for the consolidated PowerPoint presentation in PDF format, so that you can see all of the graphics that were presented. That said, if you will please pay attention to your screen, you should see a polling question to come up to indicate whether or not you are interested in supporting the proposal that Kristen has shared with us from Piedmont Housing Alliance. That said, Kristen, I would like to just take a moment to acknowledge that, yes, we are in a global pandemic related to COVID-19, but we're also very aware that we are right now confronting a lot of the social injustices that exist in our society. So we appreciate your presentation addressing some of those and your efforts. Can you talk to us a little bit about any successes that you've had in this effort, particularly in targeting low and moderate income people of color related to housing and financial stability?
Yeah, so I guess I can speak from the perspective of Piedmont Housing Alliance, our housing counseling department, and also Network to Work. So with Piedmont Housing Alliance, last fiscal year, we worked with 539 community members through one-on-one counseling, and then 202 through group education. Of those clients, 383 were Black. And then this fiscal year, we still have two quarters to go, but this fiscal year, we've worked with 468 community members through one-on-one counseling, and then 17 in group education, and of those clients, 251 were Black. We've really tried to build that up. And then with Network to Work, we're currently working with 900 job seekers. 56% of those job seekers are Black, and we're connecting with the people we hope to serve. Of those job seekers that they're working with, 84% become employed. So it really is an amazing program.
Those are some amazing success measures. Kristen, thank you so much for your presentation today, and we definitely encourage our audience to learn more about this funding opportunity in Charlottesville, Virginia. I think this is the only proposal that we have presenting today that's targeting residents and families of Charlottesville, Virginia. Thank you, Kristen.
Thank you.
So on that same vein, we're going to move to our next presenter. We'd like for you to welcome right now Erica Sims, who is the Chief Executive Officer for the Maggie Walker Community Land Trust. And Erica's going to talk to us about an initiative similarly in Central Virginia also, but targeting the Richmond area, and it's called Pilot Project to Increase Minority Homeownership in Richmond, Virginia. Erica?
Thank you, Tiffany, and I really appreciated Ms. Lucas's presentation just now, as it echoes many of the equity issues we are working on here in the Richmond region as well. We are fundraising today for $75,000 to assist in developing race-conscious programming focused on increasing Black homeownership rates in the Richmond region. Next slide, please. So first, a little bit about what we do, because it is not a common model yet in Virginia. In 3 years of operation, the Maggie Walker Community Land Trust is on track to create our first 70 permanently affordable homeownership opportunities in the Richmond region. We are growing at a fast pace, and the key to our success is the word permanent. Using the Community Land Trust model, the Maggie Walker Community Land Trust creates single-family homes that are sold to qualified low and moderate income buyers, while the land beneath the houses is held in trust. Each home has a permanent subsidy that reduces the initial sales price and stays in the house, benefiting all future homeowners. Homes in the program increase in value at the same rate as wages in the metro Richmond area, providing an opportunity for each homeowner to build wealth while ensuring that the home stays affordable for future qualified home buyers. Because real estate prices rise faster than wages in our region, as well as in so many regions throughout the country, these homes stay priced well below market value, providing affordable homeownership for generations. Next slide, please. This innovation decouples homes from the market and more closely ties them to wages and earnings. So if you look at this graph, we've been able to sell homes valued at $280,000 for $180,000. and based on our formula that restricts the sales prices in future years, in 15 years, a home like this sold for $180,000 initially would sell for $242,000 in 15 years' time in a neighborhood that appreciates similar to what some of the gentrifying neighborhoods in the Richmond region appreciate at. That is $340,000 below market value at the time of a 15-year sale, but still provides over $60,000 to the homeowner in built wealth. Next slide, please. But this is not enough. In the Richmond region, 40% of the population identifies as Black, Latinx, or Asian. But do you know how many homebuyers in the region each year are non-white? In 2017, the most current HMDA data available, only 16.4% of all home purchasers in the Richmond region identified themselves as non-white. Black home ownership has decreased by almost 30% since 2000, and white home ownership has increased almost 150% in that same time period in our region. Black home ownership rates are still exactly where they were in 1968. So much ground has been lost since the 2008 financial crisis, and households face an even steeper hill after COVID-19. Credit is tightening and economic uncertainty is skyrocketing. We are providing deeply affordable, permanently affordable homes in the Richmond community, but how do we ensure these homes address the racial wealth gap? Maggie Walker Community Land Trust has a 40% non-white homeownership rate for its homes, but we need to do more. For example, this summer, we will complete construction on 3 homes in the Churchill neighborhood of Richmond. Valued at over $300,000 each, we will sell these for $165,000 to households earning approximately 50% of the median income. But instead of identifying someone who is mortgage ready, we are identifying someone in our pipeline who has been rejected for a mortgage and working with them for a year while they occupy the home as a renter and put much of that rent into savings and repair their credit. During the pandemic and its economic fallout, this is critical work to be done so that rapidly gentrifying neighborhoods such as Churchill have a place for low and moderate income families. We seek to address gentrification in our neighborhoods and build wealth for a new generation of middle class families, but we also have another express mission to build wealth for Black households in our region. This pilot program, for which we are raising $75,000, will help us to, 1, identify best practices from throughout the country, 2, implement multiple pilots, such as the lease-to-own pilot I mentioned earlier, and 3, analyze outcomes and adjust the approach, and ultimately close the gap on our region's Black homeownership rate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Erica. Two very powerful presentations from you and Kristen in two different parts of Central Virginia. Interestingly enough, we received these proposals during the time period of March through April. And so before we knew that there would be such unrest and attention brought to this unique issue, I'd be very interested to know what is particularly unique about the community land trust model that lends itself to addressing racial equity.
One of the first things that is particularly unique is that a community land trust is governed by a board, just as all other nonprofits, but a third of our board members are homeowners. And that is critical because the land underneath these homes is held in trust. It's a community trust. So this is a fundamentally different way to think about home ownership and the ownership of land and how we structure our communities. And it gives direct voice and control to the community through governance within the organization. And we believe that these are important structures for us to develop and put in place as we are wrestling with all of these really fundamental questions through COVID and the racial equity debates that are going on right now.
Thank you, Erica. A reminder to the audience, you should see a polling question before you. We ask that you please respond and let us know if you are interested in learning more about the work of the Maggie Walker Community Land Trust. Erica, can you talk a little bit about the subsidies and how that $45,000 will be used?
Yes. So each home that we develop requires permanent subsidy, which is on average $45,000 per home. We receive land in kind primarily from the City of Richmond, which allows us to keep costs down, and that $45,000 can be used to subsidize each home so that the home can be brought to a household earning between 50 and 100% of median income.
You know, one thing that we often find at the Federal Reserve is that there are lots of unique models out there, but oftentimes, even if the model is supported, it's not shared in a way that others can learn about this model. Can you talk to us a little bit about how you anticipate sharing your findings?
Yes, yeah, so our plan would be to track our success in implementing these pilots on an annual basis and release results and data anonymized for the individuals we serve, but release results and data on an annual basis in an annual report and in a convening that we would hold where we would be able to share with funders and the community at large about the successes and the failures and the new opportunities that we've identified to continue to create these impacts with our work.
Okay, terrific. Well, again, Erica Sims, thank you for your presentation. Please feel free to reach out to Erica directly if you have interest in this program via phone or email. And if you have to leave early from our call today, we hope that you don't. But we invite you to click the survey button and to give us your feedback so we can continue to make these investment connection pitch sessions and the entire process more beneficial for our communities and our district. Next, we're going to bring up Caroline Nowry. Caroline is the VP and Director of Investor Relations with Virginia Community Capital Incorporated. Caroline's going to talk to us today about equity investment and the CDFI VCC Bank. Caroline?
Thank you, Tiffany, and good morning, everyone. As Tiffany said, I'm Caroline Nowry. I'm Director of Investor Relations at VCC. Next slide, please. VCC's mission is to support housing and community development ventures, increase jobs, and build sustainable communities by offering flexible financial products and advisory services. VCC Bank is a majority-owned subsidiary of the nonprofit Virginia Community Capital, and both entities are CDFIs, which are certified by the Department of Treasury. In addition, VCC Bank is a certified B Corp, a benefit corporation in the Commonwealth, and has an outstanding community reinvestment, or CRA, rating. Our target markets are low to moderate income people and communities in Virginia. $1.75 million in total impact dollar value. VCC's lending investment projects and leverage with other funding from partners and sources. As you'll see from the slide, some of our highlights include nearly 8,000 jobs created or retained and $28,000 of advisory services. Next slide, please. VCC offers various ways for foundations and banks and public entities to invest in VCC Bank. Today I'll be speaking about equity investments, and for banks this also qualifies for CRA. VCC Bank began offering Class B non-voting common stock in late 2018. We are seeking to raise $10 million to expand our lending capacity for communities and businesses in the Commonwealth. We are anticipating a continuing lending need by businesses and organizations as we began the reopening phase of COVID-19. To date, we've raised $3.3 million. The minimum investment is $50,000 offered to accredited investors. As a potential investor, VCC can maximize both financial and social returns for investors. We have over 144% growth in net assets since inception. We could have had this impact in Commonwealth without our partners. Since VCC Bank is not a publicly traded stock, we also have a stock buyback plan. The liquidity reserve current levels about $1 million. Oops, sorry, I dropped my mic. So next, we'll look at some of our clients and how we use equity investments to leverage lending capital. Next slide, please. VCC Bank was already an SBA lender when PPP was announced. We quickly responded to our clients' needs. We have over 60 employees
and quickly formed new teams to support small business. Approximately half our staff was dedicated to this effort, which resulted in over 303 loans totaling $29 million, over 3,500 jobs retained, 65 were minority-owned businesses, 36 loans in high poverty areas, and 83 loans in high minority areas. You'll see on the slide a couple of the clients that we helped. Hope Pharmacy, last year VCC helped get Dr. Brown's business established with an SBA-backed loan to build out her pharmacy. Our team also helped her acquire additional SBA line of credit for working capital, payroll, and inventory. When PPP funds became available, these funds were used to retain 5 employees. The next picture you'll see is the Virginia Beach CDC, and we all know that providing housing and support services is essential during this pandemic. This organization helps to provide equity, affordable housing opportunities to low and moderate income people. A Paycheck Protection Program loan is covering payroll-related costs for the CDC's 26 employees so that they can keep serving their community. To wrap up, VCC Bank provides capital or loans when clients may not be able to secure one through traditional bank. And equity investments like common stock investments help us do that. We appreciate the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond allowing us to present our proposal on the investment connection, and I'll be happy to answer any questions you have.
Thank you, Caroline. We appreciate this, your presentation, and this is certainly unique for a unique request from many of the other presentations that we've seen before. Can you talk to us a little bit about the types of clients that have invested in your stock to date?
Yeah, so we're able to really utilize a number of different clients, different investors. So banks have been investors of ours. We have high net worth individuals who've also invested with us, private foundations, community foundations, and we also have a unique investment from a local nonprofit.
Terrific. Reminding the audience, you should see a polling question before you to express your interest in learning more about the funding proposal that Caroline Nowry has presented to us today from Virginia Community Capital. So as an investor, Caroline, are dividends paid on the stock investments?
So just like other organizations, you can't guarantee that a dividend will be paid. Dividends are based on the conditions and results from the operations. So I can't predict what may happen in the future, but I can share that we did pay a dividend in 2019. And that was the first year that we offered the stock and the first year that we paid dividends.
Okay, and can you clarify, is the stock traded publicly?
It's not, no. Okay. It's called desktop trading. So the investor relations team can provide with a private placement memorandum that will have a new one in July, and the investor will complete a subscription agreement. If you need a definition of what an accredited investor is, there isn't a definition on SEC, but we also have an accredited investor questionnaire that's provided with the private placement memorandum.
Terrific. Caroline, thank you for your time today. Thank you for working with Investment Connection and providing this unique opportunity for our funding community to respond to needs that support small business lending for all populations in our area. At this time, I'm going to ask one of our presenters who's already presented to respond to a question that we've received in the queue. I apologize, sometimes there are slight delays, but this is a question that is specifically targeted to the Maggie Walker Community Land Trust. Erica Sims, are you still on the line?
Yep, I'm here.
Terrific. Erica, we received a question regarding the land that Maggie Walker Community Land Trust acquires. Can you describe how that land is acquired?
We are operating in the city of Richmond, Henrico, and Chesterfield, and we acquire land in a variety of ways.
One is with a strong partnership with the city, which has transferred tax delinquent foreclosed vacant lots to us in order to provide virtually free land to us to build these homes. We also buy homes and vacant lots on the open market. We also one of our strongest ways of acquiring land is to collaborate with other nonprofits in the area that are building affordable homes and want to preserve that affordability in perpetuity, will sell the home to a qualified buyer and sell the land to us simultaneously.
Terrific. Erica, thank you so much for jumping back in. We have a little time to play with, so I'm getting a little off the agenda, and I just need to see if we can get a response from both Carolyn Nowry and also Brian Phipps of People Incorporated, Caroline Nowry of Virginia Community Capital. Caroline, since you've just gone most recently, I'm going to ask you to respond first, but the question for both of you is, will any of the money be used to promote self-starters or startup companies that are headquartered in Richmond? And Brian, when you respond, I know that your region is different, so if you can respond related to your region. Caroline?
Yes. So typically our borrowers, you know, we do small business borrowing as a large segment as it relates to job creation and focusing on low to moderate income communities. But startups are not necessarily, for a startup to be considered, it would have to be there would have to be circumstances where there was, you know, where we would be able to underwrite it. Typically, most of our small business loans are given to businesses that have 2 years experience. However, we will consider startups that have, you know, high management skills and other varying circumstances.
Thank you, Caroline. Brian, I'm going to ask you to respond to the same question, but respond related to the geography that People Incorporated serves, and feel free to go beyond the proposal that you have provided today on consumer loans. Will any of the money that your organization receives promote self-starters or startup companies headquartered in the geography that you serve, specifying the geography that you serve?
Thanks, Tiffany. And you know, just as a refresher for folks that's there on the line, we are targeting our specific proposal for investment connection to Prince William County and the cities of Manassas and Manassas Park. And as presented, our proposal is seeking to provide, you know, direct assistance to consumers. Now, there's nothing in that would prevent any borrower from using those funds to start a business. You know, we're not requiring that for participation in the program, but again, there's nothing that would prevent it. I think it's important to note here, too, that People Incorporated is also a SBA intermediary relender. So we're very active in the SBA microloan program. I think, which as, you know, compared with VCC, we tend to specialize and concentrate a lot on startups and nascent entrepreneurs with a lot of our financing. We have access to other sources of funds that can be used specifically for that population, but that, you know, certainly we are always engaged in searching for additional opportunities to grow our small business lending. You know, we've seen a pretty significant uptick in the number of requests for financing from small businesses throughout our service area, including Prince William County. Some of the inquiries that we received once we launched some of our special initiatives, the majority of those was coming from Prince William County. So short answer to the question, they can certainly use the funds for that. They don't have to, but we also have other opportunities where we're working specifically for that purpose.
Thank you, Brian, for your response. So we are now heading into the tail end of our presentation, and we have saved one proposal, which is one of our best and one of our last proposals from the YMCA of Greater Richmond. Abby Rogers, who is the Chief Advancement Officer at the YMCA of Greater Richmond, wants to talk to us about her proposal entitled Here for Good, Supporting Our Community Through COVID-19. Abby?
Great. Thank you so much, and thank you for having us here today. The YMCA has supported the Greater Richmond region for over 165 years, evolving to meet changing community needs, and today is no different. We have a health pandemic, we have a financial pandemic, and we have a race pandemic. As one of the largest social services organizations in Central Virginia area, we've worked relentlessly to connect our community in person and now virtually to respond to the continuing new needs we're seeing in Richmond. Next slide, please. With Governor Northam's executive order to shut down Virginia to battle COVID-19, everyone's world changed. Our efforts to support our community had to morph under the new conditions and will continue to change with each new phase we encounter. That these are all going to bring a changing environment and new issues. We saw these needs in three main areas as we got into this, and they were child care, community care, and staff care. Next slide, please. So as we look at child care, we immediately after the shutdown, we heard from government agencies, hospitals, and other essential employees that child care was going to be an imperative issue since schools and normal avenues parents had for their children were closed. We began within a week our Camp Hope, which served essential employees with child care at a greatly reduced price to ensure everyone had access to the program. We served over 400 children with live and virtual enrichment, learning opportunities, and healthy activities. We followed all of the DSS and health department guidelines and created a safe and engaging program. We heard from so many families the difference this program made. For example, we had a Richmond Police Department detective and single mom express the huge relief she felt in being able to send her kids to Camp Hope. Not only did she have a safe, reliable, affordable care, enabling her to protect her precinct in Richmond's East End. Her children loved the program and were excited to come back each day. And we heard this from so many different families. So in addition to that, on June 1, as more families were going back to work, we began our summer camp programming. We have a normally run summer camp, and it's a little different this year, as everything is, but we've worked closely with experts to create a safe environment. We're running outside programs when at all possible and following all the CDC guidelines. We're currently serving close to 1,000 children and see our registrations growing through the summer as more and more people do go back to work. At the same time, we're working with Richmond Public Schools to run our Power Scholars program virtually. This will leverage the 10,000 Chromebooks that they were able to distribute to their students and help to narrow the summer learning loss issue that will be so much greater this year for all of our students. There will be virtual classrooms with teachers in the morning focused on math and literacy and enrichment programs in the afternoon with Y staff. While running these programs, we have been working closely with the 7 school systems we serve to ensure that we're able to respond to their child care needs as they create their proposals for starting school in the fall. We know that our services will look different and that families will have an essential need to have their children cared for if schools are not able to return to a full-time schedule. This will also be an additional cost to families that many of them do not normally have to undertake. Under the community care, many of our communities were affected in new and different ways during the pandemic. We look to respond to connect individuals and families to our programs or to other partners in the community. These include responding to the governor's call for lack of blood supply in Virginia. We established 12 blood drives with the American Red Cross and our facilities across the region. These drives yielded 202 pints of blood and will save 528 lives, and we'll be continuing to do these as long as there's a need. Many of you in the Richmond area saw the long lines for local food banks and heard about many of the food pantries and banks running out of food. The Y organized staff and over 200 volunteers to collect 2,500 bags of food and hygiene supplies for many community partners. We also expanded our program with the City of Richmond for Help One RVA, which is a social services navigation program that connects individuals with essential health and social needs services. Demand for this program expanded by more than 1,300% between February and May. Seniors, who were one of the most affected populations during the shutdown, were so much on our hearts. Isolation is truly a health issue for them, and we were committed to staying connected to the seniors who find their community at the Y. We called over 6,000 senior members, connected them to needed services, and had physically distant visits where possible to ensure their health, safety, and let them know that they were a valued part of our community. Virtual has spread quickly as the new way to communicate, and the Y created hundreds of virtual content through YouTube, Facebook Live, and Zoom to keep our citizens healthy, engaged, and active. Family programming to senior yoga to cooking classes to try to create an opportunity, if you were at home, as we all were, that we were there to help make it a more productive time. Our staff care, all of this was only possible because of our staff. Their smiling faces on Zoom or at the front desk of a Y is what makes us the Y. COVID has been a financial hardship on our organization, as it has so many, but keeping these people who make the difference in the lives of our members, participants, and community was a top priority for us. None of the services that we've talked about here or any of those things that we'll do in the future are possible without the dedicated staff that have been serving our community through this time and are waiting to welcome everyone back to the Y. Next slide, please. Your support is so important to ensuring that we're able to continue to do the work the Y has been doing for so long. We're committed to being here for good, but we need your help to do that. We know financial assistance in all of our programs is on the rise. The cost of programming has gone up with the CDC guidelines, and new and different programming is needed to continue to respond to the ever-changing needs because of these pandemics. We ask that you will join with us in serving our community during this trying time. Thank you so much for being here today, and we look forward to any questions you might have.
Abby, thank you so much for your presentation. Sometimes with all that's happening in the world, we forget that we are in the middle of a global pandemic, and the response of the YMCA of Greater Richmond is imperative. Personally, I have children returning to school in West Virginia and in New York, and so it's great to know that there are organizations like yours that are directly providing services to our community and responding so quickly. Absolutely. So I do have a question, and it's actually a question that I'm going to let you respond to first, so we can stay on time as quickly as you can. But also I'm going to ask Kimberly Baldridge from Habitat for Humanity in Danville, Pennsylvania County, to respond as well. And it's a question coming from our queue, and it's related to sustainability. When you think about the global pandemic going forward, how will you create a more sustainable funding stream to balance some of the layoffs and operational challenges that nonprofit organizations are facing?
Yes, so thank you very much for the question. You know, we have a very sound financial institution here who has had boards for many decades that have done a wonderful job in creating sustainability for us here. You know, we are working very hard to mitigate any losses that we have this year, looking to change our programming. Because we have this membership model that goes along with our nonprofit status, we're balancing those two pieces of it. So the long-term sustainability for us is really about being nimble to be able to respond to the community. We have found that many of our members here at the YMCA through this pandemic have stayed with us, that value the services that we have. And we have been able to cut expenses without cutting into program quality to be able to do that as we go for where we're going to be going. And then the work that we're going to be doing to be responsive from the programming standpoint, that we will be sustainable in the long term as we go forward.
Thank you so much, Abby. Kim Baldridge, are you on the line?
Yes, I am here.
Do you mind responding to the same question related to Danville, Pennsylvania County, Habitat for Humanity, how you intend to make your funding more sustainable in light of the layoffs and operational challenges?
Yes, ma'am. So we were very fortunate, as I mentioned in my presentation, to have funding through the Virginia Housing and Development Authority, local assistance to the City of Danville, as well as through the SBA Economic Injury loan to sustain us through August, hence the request of the $50,000 to carry us for our operational expenses per se from the payroll rent insurance through the rest of 2020. However, as far as our building capacity, we are very fortunate in the City of Danville and Pennsylvania County to have many local grant funders in this area, so particularly to the building side. We have many grant funders that we apply to the Danville Regional Foundation, Community Foundation of the Dan River Region, And those particular organizations help sustain our building process. But now that our restore, as well as that it is back open, that will also increase our operating income in order to not only pay our expenses on the back end, but also help us as the proceeds from the restore filter down into helping build homes as well.
Kim, thank you so much for your response. I would like to mention to the group, getting back to the YMCA of Greater Richmond and Abby Rogers' presentation on supporting our community through COVID-19, you may see a polling question indicating whether or not you have interest in learning more about that proposal. Please do respond to that. Thank you, audience, overall, for your questions submitted via Q. They were very interesting and important questions. If you'd like to know more about the YMCA of Greater Richmond, you can see Abby's contact information on the screen, both phone and email. If you came in later or had to leave and came back on, this entire presentation is available in the materials section, and you can find contact information for all of the presenters. We encourage you to reach out to them directly. In addition, we are asking that you please respond to the survey either by clicking on the survey tab right now and responding to how you experience Investment Connection. We value your feedback and want to make the program as strong as possible as we look to expand it. Per Christy Clear's remarks, you will also receive a link to the survey via email. So at this time, thank you to all of our presenters for doing a phenomenal job for bringing your energy and urgency to your presentations. They were all very thoughtful, and they're all very meaningful and will make an impact in our community, both to address the impacts of the global pandemic as well as the racial injustices that are clear before us today. We appreciate your patience with our program. I would like to use my last moments to send a tremendous thank you to Jean Wark for helping us pull together these webinars, both for our June 2nd cohort of presenters as well as this June 23rd cohort of presenters. She did a phenomenal job and makes it look like I am much more organized than I actually am. So, and Jess, at this time, I think that we are going to end the call. And again, thank you all for sticking with us through the end.